بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الحمد لله تعالى نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون، أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كلام الله، وخير الهدى هدى محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
In our class today of Kitab al-Tawheed, we're going to move on to the next chapter, which is Fadlu al-Tawheed. Fadlu al-Tawheed, it means the Fadl of Tawheed. Wal-Fadlu fi lugha arabiya al-ziyada. And whenever we use the word in Arabic, Fadl, it means something which is extra or has more. Meaning the extra benefits, the extra virtues and excellences of something. So here, Fadlu Tawheed, it means the excellence of Tawheed above all other deeds. This is what this chapter is all about. Bayan Fadlu Tawheed. The excellence of Tawheed above all other deeds. وَمَا يُكَفِّرُ مِنَ الذُّنُوبِ. And how Tawheed, it expiates sins, major and minor sins. Or the effects of Tawheed in expiating sin. So the Mu'allif, the author says, Fadlu Tawheed, the excellence of Tawheed. And as we know, in our definition of Tawheed, Tawheed is of three categories. Which category of Tawheed is he speaking about here? Uluhiyya. Because the cause of contention and argument between the messengers and people was what? Uluhiyya or Ibadah. They all acknowledge Allah is the creator of the heavens and the earth. Allah is the provider. But in the actual practice of worship and Allah alone, this is where the issue came, the contention. So the excellence of Tawheed al-Uluhiyya and that which expiates from sins. So the author, to prove this chapter, it brings about five evidences. So we're going to go through five proofs about the excellence of Tawheed. The first of these proofs, he said, وَقَوْلُهُ تَعَالَى, the saying of Allah, الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَلَمْ يَلْبِسُوا إِيمَانَهُمْ بِظُلْمٍ أُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمُ الْأَمْنُ وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُهْتَدُونَ. Allah says, those who have iman and they do not mix with their iman ظلم, oppression, أُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمُ الْأَمْنُ, they guaranteed safety, security, وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُهْتَدُونَ, and they're the guided ones. In this ayah, Allah Ta'ala says, الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, those who have iman. In other words, those who believe. What is al-iman? It's very important to know. When we say iman, what is iman? Iman lughatan, iman linguistically is what? It is al-tasdiq, to believe in something. Like the brothers of Yusuf, they said to their father, you're never going to believe us concerning what we're saying concerning Yusuf. وَلَوْ كُنَّا مُؤْمِنِينَ, even if we're speaking the truth. So al-iman, lughatan, linguistically, is a tasdeeq, to say something truthful. وَالشَّرَعًا, according to the sharia, according to Islam, what is al-iman? This is a very important definition for those taking notes. Al-iman, number one, اعتقاد بالقلب. Al-i'tiqad بالقلب, to believe something in your heart. Number two, وَقَوْلُ بِاللِّسَانِ, and statements of the tongue. So it's not enough, for example, for somebody to say La ilaha illallah with his tongue without what? Believing in their heart. And that's what Allah Ta'ala says about the munafiqun. قَالُوا نَشْهَدُ, they say with their tongue, we bear witness, إِنَّكَ لَرَسُولُ اللَّهِ, verily, verily the messenger of Allah. وَاللَّهُ يَعْلَمُ إِنَّكَ لَرَسُولُ وَاللَّهُ يَشْهَدُ إِنَّ الْمُنَافِقِينَ لَكَاذِبُونَ. Allah Ta'ala says, it bears witness in munafiqeen, they are liars. So it's not enough to say with the tongue, you have to believe in your heart. وَالْعَمَلْ بِالْأَرْكَانِ, and actions of the limbs. So action enters into iman. So when Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala said, those who believe, it means with their tongue. with their heart and also actions of the limb. And this iman yazidu bi ta'ati ar-Rahman, it increases with the obedience of ar-Rahman. Wa yanqusu bi ta'ati ash-shaytan, and it goes down with the obedience of a shaytan. So this is iman according to sharia. So those who have this belief with their heart, tongue and actions of the limbs, Allah Ta'ala said, وَلَمْ يَلْبِسُوا, they do not mix it with ظُلْم. What is a ظُلْم? The definition of ظُلْم, وَضْعُ شَيْءٍ فِي غَيْرِ مَوْضِعِهِ, is to give something that does not deserve that thing, or to place something in the wrong place. This is ظُلْم. وَهِيَ ثَلَاثَةُ أَنْوَعٍ, and is of three types. The first type of ظُلْم, oppression, ظُلْمُ الشَّخْصِ لِنَفْسِهِ, a person to oppress their own self. How does a person oppress themselves? By sinning. The second time, ظُلْمُ الشَّخْصِ لِلْغَيْرِ, for somebody to oppress somebody else. And the third type of ظُلْم is الشِّرْكُ, associating partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is the worst type of oppression. Because وَضْعُ الشَّيْءٍ, you've given something that doesn't deserve it, or place it in the wrong place. And that's why Imam al-Nawawi rahimahullahu ta'ala, he said that man ja'ala al-ibada li ghayri Allahi fa huwa ablamu al-zalimin. Whoever dedicates or devotes any act of worship to other than Allah is from the worst of oppressors. So those people that shout, no justice, no peace. Any injustice is injustice anywhere. The greatest injustice is shirk. The worst type of dhulm is shirk, associate partners of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this ayah here, what is it referring to? Which type of dhulm is it referring to? It's referring to what? Shirk. Because when this ayah was revealed, the sahaba radiallahu anhum, they came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when this ayah was revealed, ayyuna لا يظلم نفسه أينا لا يلبس بإيمانه ظلم. Which one of us doesn't mix with his faith some oppression? Which one of us doesn't oppress himself? Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to them, ليس الذي تذهبون إليه, it is not what you think. ألم تسمعوا, have you not heard the statement of the righteous servant لقمان, إن الشرك لظلم عظيم, that shirk is the greatest oppression. So this ayah, Allah Ta'ala said, those who believe and did not mix with their iman, ظلم, oppression, meaning shirk, أُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمُ الْأَمْنِ, they guarantee safety. Safety here means يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ, from the hellfire. In one or two ways. Either تحريم الدخول, they will not enter the hellfire at all, or تحريم الخلود, or they're not abide in the hellfire forever. There's those that will not enter it at all because they don't have kabair, major sins. And there's those that were consistent upon major sin, but as long as they die upon tawheed, they will not abide in the hellfire forever. وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُعْتَدُونَ, Allah Ta'ala said, these are the ones that are guided, meaning عَرَفُ الْحَقِّ, they know the truth and they act according to the truth. As for this ayah, the fawaid, the benefits of this ayah. The first benefit of this ayah is number one, لا صحة للإيمان مع الشرك. Any iman or so-called iman with shirk is invalid. There's no iman with shirk. With the presence of shirk, associate partners of Allah, there's no iman. Number two, تسميت الشرك ظلما, that Allah Ta'ala called shirk, or he named it as ظلم, as oppression. So in the world to say today, we see a lot of oppression. But the greatest oppression is what? Shirk. Shirk is the greatest of oppression, the greatest dhulm. And what we see from oppression in the world today, it hurts us. We have to fight all types of oppression. But this oppression of shirk is the greatest that we need to speak against. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala concerning the shirk, and da'wa lirrahmani walada, from the shirk or the kuffar, that they claim Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a son. تَكَادُ السَّمَاوَاتِ, if these creations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, like the heavens, they had feeling, يَتَفَطَّرْنَا, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, if the heavens had emotion, the heavens will rent asunder, and the mountains will crumble, and دَعْوَ لِرَحْمَانِ وَلَدَى, that they claim Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a son. Subhanallah. The worst oppression, oppression of shirk. Number three, whoever does not mix his iman with dhulm, he has security from the hellfire. and they're the guided ones. So from the excellence of Tawheed, which is the chapter of this book, what is the excellence of Tawheed according to this ayah? Number one, al-ihtida, you be guided. And number two, safety from the hellfire. In this ayah, where is the mention of Tawheed in this ayah? Al-ladhina amanu, those who believe and did not mix with their iman shirk. Where's the mention of Tawheed here? Where's the mention of Tawheed? The mention or the mid-na'am. Sorry? La. وَلَمْ يَلْبِسُوا They did not mix with the iman. Dhulm. Dhulm is what? Shirk. And in our definition of Tawheed last week, we said At-Tawheed diddu shirk. Tawheed is the opposite of shirk. So the mention of shirk here is لَمْ يَلْبِسُوا بِإِيمَانِهِمْ ذُلْمُ Because Tawheed is the opposite of what? Of shirk. The second evidence the author rahimahullah ta'ala he brings is a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam concerning the excellence of at-tawheed. Na'am. And that's a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam in which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam he said The hadith of Ubadah ibn Samit that man shahida an la ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika la wa anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluhu wa anna Isa abdullah wa rasuluhu wa kalimatuhu alqaha ila Maryam wa ruhun minhu wal jannatu haqqun wal naru haqqun adkhalahu Allahu al jannata ala ma kana min al amal Ubadah ibn Samit he said the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said man shahida an la ilaha illallah Whoever bears witness there is no deity worthy of worship in truth but Allah, and that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam abduhu wa rasuluhu is his servant and messenger. Here, servant, it means he doesn't have any attributes of uluhiyya, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam does not deserve or doesn't have any rights of uluhiyya or ibadah to be worshipped. He's a servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So any act of worship that anybody directs to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, such as dua, such as calling upon him, not permissible. He's a abd, he's a servant of Allah azza wa jal. Wa rasuluhu, and bears witness is his messenger. Whenever we say we bear witness Muhammad Rasulullah, what is the meaning of shahada Muhammad Rasulullah? This is very important. It means ta'atuhu fi ma amara. You have to obey him in anything which he orders you. There's no such thing as it's only sunnah. وَمَا آتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوهُ Whatever the message is given, you must take it. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ رَسُولِ إِلَّا لِيُطَاعُ بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ Allah said He did not send a messenger except to be obeyed by the permission of Allah. So when you say, I bear witness Muhammad is the messenger of Allah, it means طَاعَتُهُ You must obey Him in everything He orders you. وَاجْتِنَابَ مَا نَهَى عَنْهُ وَزَجَرُ And to abstain from everything he has prohibited you from and warned you about. وَتَصْدِيقُهُ فِيمَا أَخْبَرُ You have to believe everything which he has told you. Also, this is the meaning of Muhammad Rasulullah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you bear witness is the messenger of Allah. And then I want to say, وَأَنَّ عِيسَى And likewise, Isa is Abdullah, the servant of Allah وَرَسُولُهُ A servant of Allah, not the son of Allah. وَرَسُولُهُ And a messenger of Allah. كَلِمَتُهُ أَلْقَاهَا إِلَى مَرْيَمْ Allah's kalima that he gave to Maryam. Allah's word. What does it mean here, Allah's word? What is Allah's word when it comes to Isa? The ulama, they say Allah's word to Isa is Allah Ta'ala said, كُنْ فَكَانَ Be and he was. This is kalimatullah concerning Isa. He didn't have a what? A father. So Allah Ta'ala said, Kun fakan. This is kalimatullah. Wa ruhun minhu. And a spirit or soul that Allah Ta'ala created. Wal jannatu haq. And that the hellfire is real. Wal naru haqqun. And wal jannatu haqqun. The paradise is real. Wal naru haq. And the hellfire is real. Adkhalahu Allahu al jannata. Ala ma kana min al amali. Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala will enter into the paradise no matter what his deeds were. No matter what is these words. This hadith is also from the excellence of Tawheed. That no matter what a person was upon, Allah Ta'ala from deeds, meaning good deeds or bad deeds, Allah will enter them into Jannah. And دخول إلى الجنة in one or two ways. Either دخول في الحال ابتداء and enters paradise immediately. أو في مآل. أو eventually. Meaning it may go to the hellfire first. But so long as that one tawheed, it will enter the Jannah, the paradise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Subhanallah. So from the benefits of tawheed is the greatest, I mean أعظم الأسباب, the greatest causes of a person to enter the paradise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, from the fawaid of the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is that a person along with tawheed, iman, he must have what? Deeds, actions. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ma kana alayhi min al-amal, no matter what his deeds were. The next hadith that is mentioned by the author, rahimahullah ta'ala, concerning the fadl, the excellence of tawheed, is the saying of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The third evidence, which the author mentions, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, whoever bears witness to a shahada, meaning فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ حَرَّمَ عَلَى النَّارِ مَنْ قَالَ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَى اللَّهِ يَبْتَغِي بِذَلِكَ وَجْهَ اللَّهِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made impermissible the hellfire for whoever says or bears witness to La ilaha illallah, يَبْتَغِي, seeking with that وَجْهُ اللَّهِ, the face of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the excellence of tawheed in this is number one, that tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is from the greatest cause of tahreem ala nar, for a person not to enter the hellfire, either not at all or to abide in the hellfire at all. Number two, the importance of what? When it comes to bear witness, there's no deity worthy worship of Allah. The importance of what? Seeking what? Seeking Allah, al-ikhlas. And this is one of the conditions of La ilaha illallah, al-ikhlas, that the person has to do it sincerely. That you say sincerely. Because as we all know, La ilaha illallah, miftahul jannah. La ilaha illallah is the key to jannah. وَلَكِنْ مَا مِنْ مِفْتَاحِ إِلَّا وَلَهُ الْأَسْنَانِ. Every key has a teeth. It has conditions. And from the conditions is what? Ikhlas. You have to say it sincerely. Another important condition for what you gathered for here today is al-ilm, knowledge. Knowledge, very, very important. Allah Ta'ala, He told the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, He's addressing him. فَعَلَّمْ, have knowledge, أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهِ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. This ayah is in which surah? Ya Muhammad. Na'am, surah to Muhammad, Ya Muhammad. This ayah is in surah to Muhammad. And Allah Ta'ala is addressing the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. طيب. The next evidence, or the fourth evidence, the mu'allif rahimahullah ta'ala, the author, he mentions, is a long hadith. The hadith of Musa, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks to Musa. He said, Ya Rabb, علمني حديث سعيد الخدري رضي الله عنه. That Musa said, Ya Rabb, O my Lord, علمني شيئا أذكرك وأدعوك به. O my Lord, teach me something that I could call upon you with, meaning praise you with, and also invoke you with. قال يا موسى, he said, Musa, Allah Ta'ala said, Musa, say la ilaha illallah. Say la ilaha illallah. Musa alayhi salatu wassalam, he said, Ya Rabb, kullu ibadik yaquluna hadha. All your servants, they say la ilaha illallah. So Musa alayhi salatu wassalam, he wanted something special for him, yakhtassu bihi, only for him, that he could call upon Allah with and praise Allah with. So Allah said, say la ilaha illallah. Musa said, all your servants say la ilaha illallah. Then Allah Ta'ala said, Ya Musa, O Musa, لو أن السماوات السبع, if the seven heavens, وعامرهن, and the inhabitants of the seven heavens, غيري, except for me and Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala, والأرضين السبع, and the seven earth, في كفة were to be placed upon a scale. Were to be placed upon a scale. And لا إله إلا الله في كفة and لا إله إلا الله was to be placed upon a scale. مالت بهن لا إله إلا الله. لا إله إلا الله far away all of that. Subhanallah. The seven heavens and its inhabitants, except for Allah Azza wa Jal, and the seven earth. لا إله إلا الله far outweighs all of that. This shows the excellence of Tawheed, thiqal Tawheed, the heaviness of this kalimatu, la ilaha illallah. Wa min fawaid, from the benefits of this hadith, number one, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is attributed to him, that Allah ta'ala, he speaks. Qawl, Allah ta'ala, he speaks. He spoke to Musa. From the benefits of this hadith, is that a person seeks or does a tawassul, seeks a way to approach Allah Azza wa Jal in a way which is permissible in Sharia. Or that a person seeks something special by which he could remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with. As Musa alayhi salatu wassalam, he did here. From the benefits of this hadith, as we mentioned, is the fadl of Tawheed, the weight of Tawheed, of La ilaha illallah. Tayyib. The last hadith, which the author he mentions here, after the hadith of Musa alayhi salam, is the hadith of Qudsi, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, قال الله تعالى, Allah ta'ala said, يا ابن آدم, إنك لو أتيتني بقراب الأرض خطايا ثم لقيتني لا تشرك بي شيئا لأتيتك بقرابها مغفرة. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in this hadith Qudsi that O Ibn Adam, O son Adam, if you succumb to me with the old earth, bil khataya, sins, disobedience, all sorts of acts, evil acts, thumma laqitani, you meet me Allah Azza wa Jal, without associating the partners with me, or you seek the forgiveness of Allah Azza wa Jal, la ataytuka, I'll come to you with a similitude, maghfirah, in forgiveness. Subhanallah. Because of Tawheed. And that's why, if you look at Sahaba to see how Tawheed yukaffiru dhunub, Amr ibn al-As used to be one of the greatest enemies of al-Islam, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And when he accepted al-Islam, and in those days, they would give bay'ah to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by holding the hand of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he put his hand in the hand of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to give bay'ah, pledge of allegiance. And Amr, all of a sudden, he removed his hand from the hand of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Amr, ma lak? What is wrong with you, Amr? He said, ashtarit, I want to put a condition before I accept Islam. Because he harmed Islam and the Muslims greatly. He said, the condition is that Allah forgives me my previous sins. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he laughed. He said, أَلَمْ تَعْلَمْ يَا عَمَرْ أَنَّ الْإِسْلَامِ يَجُبُّ مَا قَبْلَهُ. Do you not know, Amr, that Islam, it destroys, knocks out, demolishes whatever preceded before it. Subhanallah. The fadl of Tawheed. That whatever you've done, you start with a clean slate. Is that right? Do they start with a clean slate, whoever accepts Islam upon Tawheed? And that's why sometimes, when people think to themselves, or some people say, Are you a real Muslim or you accepted Islam? And sometimes we think we're better. You know? And it doesn't matter. Even sometimes, it's a major, major mistake that generationally, you could have somebody is a Muslim, his son is a Muslim, grandchildren Muslim, but people will still ask, like, are you a real, real Muslim? You don't accepted Islam. Thinking they're what? Thinking they're better. This is nonsense. The Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they were converts, they accepted Islam. And these people that accept Islam with our years and our time in Islam, they accept Islam today, they're in a better state than us. Because they start with a what? Clean slate. They don't start with a clean slate, they start with credit. Because whatever they did from good deeds, Allah Ta'ala records it for them. So they're starting with credit. Not only did they start with credit, you know, sometimes when these different phone companies or different people, they want you to join them, they'll offer you things, right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, nor did they start with a credit. هذا, this hadith in fawaidihi, fadl, the excellence of Allah azza wa jal, wasi'a jiddan, vast. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whatever they've done, fadlu rahmatillah, wa wasi'a rahmatillah, how vast Allah's mercy is. Whatever they've done, khalas. Allah will come with his light in forgiveness. Not only did it start with a credit, this hadith, somebody's come with the earth, the whole earth, the likes of the whole earth, similitude, in sins. And what does Allah give them? Forgiveness. So they say, min fadli hadha al-hadith, of wa'id hadha al-hadith, is tabdeelu sayyi'a bil-hasana. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he exchanges evil deeds with good deeds. He turns evil deeds, if somebody comes to Allah Azza wa Jawa Tawheed, into good deeds. And that's why Yawm Al-Qiyamah, before the Tawheed, the servant of Allah Azza wa Jal, he will come to Allah Azza wa Jal. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who died upon Tawheed, in a hadith, in a conversation between him and Allah Azza wa Jal only, nobody will hear it. Allah will say, on this day you did this, you did that, you did this. Subhanallah. And at that moment, the servant would think, halakt, I'm finished, I'm destroyed. And nobody could hear it except for him and the people who are watching the servant. And the servant of Allah Ta'ala, ya'tarif, he admits, he confesses, na'am, I did. Then Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala will say to him, such and such, because he came with Tawheed, that you did, ghafartu lak, I forgive you. One by one. And this servant, every time Allah says, I forgive you, prostrate to Allah. Because the others could not hear this Yawm Al-Qiyamah, they say, هَذَا الرَّجُ مَا عَمِلَ إِلَّا خَيْرٌ مَا عَمِلَ يعني شَرًّا قَطْ. He's never done a bad deed, because he's just prostrating to Allah, just prostrating to Allah. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, see all these sayyi'at, all those evil deeds you did, I've turned it into good deeds for you. These are the people Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أُولَٰئِكَ يُبَدِّلُ اللَّهِ سَيِّئَاتِهِمْ حَسَنًا. These are the people Allah Ta'ala will turn all their evil deeds into good deeds. In fadli tawheed, the excellence of worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. Subhanallah. The Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala, ba'da hadha, after this, or before this, from the fadli of this hadith, as we mentioned, is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he speaks. The excellence or the vastness or the mercy and the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for those who die upon Tawheed. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala exchanges or turns bad deeds into good deeds. So the author rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentions these five evidences. After this, he said rahimahullah ta'ala, masail, based on everything we looked at, important topics or things we derive from this. Number one, the extent of Allah's favor. The reward Allah grants for Tawheed. By virtue of this, it removes sins. So when you look at dua, Sayyidul Istighfar, or any dua which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if you make this dua, Allah will answer it. It's always mixed with what? At-Tawheed. For example, a sahabi, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, heard him saying, Allahumma inni as'aluka, O Allah, I only ask you, bi annaka anta Allah, la ilaha illa ant. The one that is no deity worthy of worship but him. Al-Mannan, Badi'u al-Samawati wal-Ard, Ya Dha al-Jalal wal-Ikram, Ya Hayya Qayyum. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لَقَدْ دَعَوْتَ اللَّهِ. You've called upon Allah, بِإِسْمِهِ, by his name, الَّذِي إِذَا دُعِيَ بِهِ أَجَابْ. If you call upon Allah by this name, he answers you. وَإِذَا سُئِلَ, if Allah asks with this name, أَعْطَ, he'll give you definitely. To show the excellence of Tawheed. Likewise, say you the istighfar, Allahumma, أنت ربي لا إله إلا أنت خلقتني وأنا عبدك وأنا على أهدك ووعدك ما استطعت. استغفار mixed with التوحيد. Number five, the explanation of the ayah, or four explanation ayah in Surah An'am. Number five, the five points posed in the hadith of Ubadah ibn Samit. Number six, when we look at the hadith of Ithban, in which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, whoever bears witness to La ilaha illallah, And whatever it dies upon, meaning La ilaha illallah, of statement and actions, it becomes clear to you the misconceptions of those who are delusional. Delusional meaning they believe or they think it suffices to say La ilaha illallah without either proper belief or deeds. This is a great misconception that many Muslims have today. So you find Muslims, they go and give da'wah. They say the most important thing, we just want our brothers to say the kalima. You have Muslims that go around like this, the kalima. And these same Muslims that are going around saying we just want them to say the kalima, you find in some of their actions things that contradict La ilaha illallah, from shirk and false beliefs. So it's not enough just to say the kalima, the proper belief. Nor is it enough for your brothers and sisters to say the kalima and they don't act by the dictates. It has dictates of La ilaha illallah. Number 7, noting the condition in the hadith of Ithbat of La ilaha illallah. Number 8, the prophets were in need. And this is a great point here. The prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala were in need of the virtues of La ilaha illallah. Allah pointed out to them. Musa alayhi salatu wasalam is a messenger of Allah. Not only is a messenger of Allah, min ulil azm, from the greatest of the messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, yet Allah had to remind him of what? The virtue of La ilaha illallah. If this is a messenger from the messengers of Allah, what about us? And that's why the ulama, the scholars say, the issue of tawheed, there's no issue that deserves to be taught more, learnt more, spread more, repeated more than tawheed. Allah Ta'ala said, وَذَكِّرْ فَإِنَّ ذِكْرَ تَنْفَعُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Remind for very minor benefits of believer. And I give you this as a principle. Any place you go to, any speaker you listen to, any khutbah for a long period you listen to from an individual, there's no tawheed in it at all. He doesn't ever speak about tawheed. Either because I don't want to divide the people, I want this Coca-Cola fizz, Iman fizz and fizz down, I want to be an entertainer, there's a major issue there. There's nothing that deserves to be taught more than a tawheed. If this is Musa, Allah's reminding him of the virtues, we need to be reminded more than anybody. Because when you speak to many Muslims, they know tawheed is, we all know La ilaha illallah. But the real application, the issues we're facing today, is due to a lack of tawheed. Because they say every sin is a branch of kufr, or a branch of shirk, even if it's not a major shirk. So when you find people disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, either by not lowering their gaze, it goes back to what? To tawheed. And that's why when the Salaf, a person asked him, how do I lower my gaze? He said, بِعِلْمِكَ, by your knowledge. أَنَّ نَظَرَكَ إِلَى الْمَنْظُورِ, by your knowledge. That whatever you're looking at on your mobile phone, on Twitter, privately, مَسْبُوخ بِنَظَرِ اللَّهِ إِلَيْهِ, that before that Allah is looking at you. And that's why even major sins such as zina, what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say? Wazani, the fornicator or the adulterer, who does not marry anybody, illa what? Illa, except for a fornicator like himself, or a mushrika, or polytheist. Why polytheist? They said the one that falls into this sin at that moment is as though he's lost awareness of Allah Ta'ala completely. What the ummah is going through today, sometimes from cowardism, from laziness, from fear, is a lack of tawheed. So there's nothing that deserves reminding more than tawheed. Number 10, the text proving that there are 7 earths. So there are 7 earths, in the same way there are 7 heavens, there are 7 earths and 7 heavens. That they have inhabitants, confirming the attributes contrary to the Ash'ari'ah. Because in this hadith, يَبْتَغِ بِهِ وَجْهِ اللَّهِ, seeking the face of Allah Azza wa Jalla. The Ash'ari, they don't believe in these attributes. You understand? Because they say, you're comparing Allah to the human being. How can you say Allah has a face? I have a face, Allah has a face. So my bag here has a hand, I have a hand. Is it the same? It's not the same. So they're the ones in their head, out of wanting to compare, دَخَلُوا مَا فَرُّوا مِنْ, they entered into what they were fleeing from. So the Ash'a'ira, when it comes to the attributes of Allah, they say, no, don't say Allah has a hand. Don't say Allah has a face. You're comparing Allah to His creation. But Allah Ta'ala says, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. And it's important for our tawheed. Allah Ta'ala shares certain or has certain attributes, same attributes as us. Alim, Hakim, Aziz. Can you call a human being Aziz? Naam. ولكن ليس كمثله شيء. It's not like Allah عز وجل. Like Allah says to Yusuf. وقالت امرأة العزيز. The wife of Al-Aziz. The minister. Do you understand? Can you call a human being Alim? Naam. Alim. It's Surah Al-Insan. But it's ilm. It's not the ilm of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number 13. That when you know the hadith of Anas radiallahu anhu, that Allah is prohibited from the five words, says, La ilaha illallah, seeking His face is by avoiding shirk, not simply saying La ilaha illallah. So it's not enough you just say La ilaha illallah, you're doing shirk. So you cannot say La ilaha illallah and go to grave Allan or Fulan. Oh, please, please take my dua, accept my dua. Even if you're doing it for them to take your dua to Allah Azza wa Jal, there's no difference between that shirk and the shirk of the mushrikeen. Because Allah Ta'ala said, وَالَّذِينَ تَخَذُ مِن دُونِهِ أَوْلِيَاءَ مَا نَعْبُدُهُمْ إِلَّا لِيُقَرِّبُونَ إِلَى اللَّهِ زُلْفَى. We don't worship these things. It's only for them to take our dua to Allah. You cannot be saying La ilaha illallah and wearing a ta'weez or talisman around your neck. This is not enough just to say it without the actions. Also, nothing, the application of worshipper of Allah and His Messenger to both Isa and Muhammad, that they're the messengers of Allah. And there's nothing more honorable than you being an abd, a servant of Allah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, can we praise him? Naam, but we don't exaggerate his praise. What is the best praise you could give the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? What's the best praise? Huh? He has many different praises. From the best praises is what? To call him abd, a slave of Allah. There's nothing more honorable than being a slave of Allah. And that's why from Tawheed, the best of names are what? Abdurrahman, Abdullah, and Amatullah. If you look at the most glorious, the most, subhanallah, highest of levels and miracles of the Prophet ﷺ, that moment, what does Allah Ta'ala call him? A abd. Subhanalladhi asra bi'abdihi. Look at that mi'raj. Allah Ta'ala refers to him as what? A abd, a slave. Who took his servant, his slave, on the night ascension. So we praise the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as a abd. And we praise him as what? Khalilu Rahman, Khalilullah, the Khalil of Allah. Many people think the praise of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by saying Habib, Habibullah. La. The best is Khalil. Because the highest form of love is what? Al-Khullah. It's Khalilullah. Naam. Also, noting, knowing that Isa was particularized as a word. And we say the word of Allah concerning Isa is what? Kun fayakun. Or kun fakana. And this is another mistake people make when they make a dua. They say, Ya Allah, man amruhu ba'da kaf wa noon. Oh Allah, the one that is order is after kaf and noon. After, or bayna kaf wa noon, afwan. Between kaf and noon. Is Allah's order between kaf and noon? La, ba'da kaf wa noon. Oh, bayna kaf wa noon. Ba'da kaf wa noon, meaning kun fayakun. Tayyib. Knowing the virtues of faith in paradise and the fire. Be aware of his saying, whatever his deeds may be, the weighness that the scale has two pans. The usage of the term, as we mentioned, face of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you see these points of aqidah that people think it's just theoretical, mental gymnastics. Okay, Ash'ari don't believe, we believe in a face, it's just theology. No, that theology, if you understand it properly, it has an effect upon you, an effect upon your behavior, even the issue of a face. Like Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, he used to feed the poor people, free the slaves, feed the prisoners. And the people said, why do you do all of this? He said, I do this, why? I'm seeking the face of Allah Azza wa Jal. And we have to know, Yawm al-Qiyamah, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enters the people into paradise, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask them, oh my servant, can I do anything more for you? And the servant say, no, you entered into Jannah, you've honored us, and so on and so forth. Then Allah Ta'ala says, I'll give you something more than Jannah. And what is more than Jannah? Another ila wajillah, to see the face of Allah Azza wa Jal. Which is why Allah Ta'ala says, لِلَّذِينَ أَحْسَنُوا, those who do good, husna, it will give them good, that's Jannah. وَالزِّيَادَ, to see the face of Allah Azza wa Jal. So hoping for that, see that, and understanding, believing that, inshallah Ta'ala, increase us indeed. Inshallah Ta'ala, We stop here, بإذن الله تعالى, and we'll continue. If there's any questions, barakallahu feekum. I'd encourage as well, if the brothers can, take some notes. After a session or some time, I know brothers, when I mentioned this last week, I've been asking questions, some people said they're not going to come this week. Well, we'll not be doing that. We'll try and have a test on WhatsApp or paper test or something like that. And it's important to write things down. Because through writing down, subhanAllah, though you may think you might miss some parts of the lecture, and I'll give myself an example here, that you may forget something. Today, I asked my son, Luqman, to pack everything for the class. The brother couldn't come, pack the recorder, the battery is dead. I told him to pack the books, and guess what? He didn't pack the book. But because I'd been writing, it is somewhere in here. Somewhere in here. It's very important to take notes. Very, very important, especially with a class like this, inshallah ta'ala. Any questions, inshallah? No questions. For you. Now. Sorry? The who? The who? Oh, the kuffar will never accept Islam? If he's alive, while he's still alive, so when he dies, nah. Their reward is only in this dunya. The level of deeds will determine the level of what? Of the hellfire. But all of them will abide in the hellfire forever. Now. So they say, when it comes to the kuffar yawm al-qiyamah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, al-adl al-mahab, pure justice. But when it comes to the believer, adl ma'al-fadl, justice with what? Bounties. It will not be pure justice. If it was pure justice, none of them entered Jannah. But the kuffar, pure justice. Now. Yes. So you believe in Tawheed, you believe in La ilaha illallah. Yeah, there's a deficiency in Tawheed. And a person therefore needs to work upon his Tawheed. So when you find yourself sinning, disobeying Allah Azza wa Jal, you need to work on your what? A Tawheed. And work on deeds. Because that's why in the beginning we said those who believe and did not mix with their iman, what? Dhulm. Oppression. And we said belief is not only statements of the tongue, belief in the heart and what actions of the limbs. So one of the ways a person works upon his iman is through good deeds. Because we said iman increases what? With obedience. So the first thing a person should look at when he has this behavior is to look at what is salah. Because Allah Ta'ala said, إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ تَنْهَا عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَمُنْكَرِ. Salah, it prevents from evil behavior. Look at your salah. Not that am I praying 5 times a day only. Am I praying as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has instructed us to pray from Allahu Akbar all the way to Assalamu alaikum rahmatullah. Assalamu alaikum rahmatullah. Do I have evidence for what I'm doing? Number two, most importantly, the khushu'. Do I pray? Do I understand what I'm saying during the salah? Because if you know what you're saying during the salah, the Fatiha, Subhana Rabbi al-Azim, it has an effect upon you. And that's Allah Ta'ala to aqim as-salah, establish salah. And then the ayah, وَلَا ذِكْرُ اللَّهِ أَكْبَرُ, the remembrance of Allah is greater. This is very important. Now, last question, inshallah. Now. For what? Now, the brother's asking, some people, they may do the remembrance, La ilaha illallah, for a portion of the day. Now, when it comes to remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, does those remembrance act of ibadah, which is, could be done restrictively or unrestrictively. For example, saying astaghfirullah 100 times, or you could say astaghfirullah unrestricted, or la ilallah wahdahu la sharika la lahu mulku wa lahu alhamdu, as azkar sabah, wa ala kulli shayin qadir, 10, 1, or 100. And likewise, la ilaha illallah, you could say it unrestrictively. You know, remember, la ilaha illallah, la ilaha illallah, la ilaha illallah. It's fine to do so. Of course, I mean by that, not in jama'ah, not in the congregation, as you find some people, they have halaqat, circles of dhikr, la ilaha, but you could say la ilaha illallah. Na'am. And all that goes back to the intention. In the same way, to show the excellence of tawheed, the sahabi, they complained about, because every single salah, you read suratul ikhlas. So they went to complain to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that every single salah, ikhlas, ikhlas, qul huwallahu ahad, Allahu samad, lam yalid wa lam yulad wa lam yakul lahu kufuwan ahad. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked him, why do you do this? He said, fihi sifatu rabb, in it is the attributes of Allah azza wa jal. So I love it. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, ahabbakallahu, Allah ta'ala, he loves you lihubbika iyaha, for you loving that surah. Because this surah is a tawheed. And that's why, again, to show the importance of the tawheed, that when the mushrikeen, the Prophet, they came to the Prophet, they said, Sif lana Rabbah. Who is this Allah you're talking about? Describe him to us. Allah sat down, Qul huwa Allahu ahad. And that's why it's a third of the Quran, to show the importance of the tawheed. And that's why the first prayer of the day before Fajr, what is the sunnah to read? Kafirun and Qul huwa Allahu ahad. The last salah, Witr, Kafirun, because they complete what? La ilaha illallah. In Qul Yahya Kafirun is what? La ilaha. In Ikhlas is what? Illallah. Now, we stop here, inshallah. Barakallahu.